Hello and welcome to the Nuit Report for February 27th, the week of February 27th. I'm April Shaley of aprilsastrology.com, and I'm very pleased that you're here with me this week so we can talk about what's going on. We've got a full moon in Virgo, conjunct black moon Lilith. That's kind of a big deal, so we're going to talk about that. That's coming up this week. Venus is making some aspects to the Uranus-Pluto square. We're going to talk about that. The Sun conjunct Neptune. We're just coming off of that as the energy is building into this full moon. So we've got lots to talk about. But first I want to mention that the new online six-week class that follows Astrology Basics, it's called Intermediate Astrology. Not the most creative name in the world, but you get the picture. It's a six-week online course. Starts on March 18th and runs for 6 weeks. It's online, live, with me, talking about transits, progressions, solar returns, all that good stuff. If you want to know what that means, those things are, that's the class for you. It's sort of divinatory astrology, timing, seasons, both inner microcosm and how that relates to the greater cosmos macrocosm. So I look forward to you joining me. There's more information in the links. You can look in the here on YouTube or just go to my website at aprilsastrology.com and you can find all the information that you need to be able to sign up. And I hope to see you there. So yeah, full moon in Virgo at 14 degrees. It's going to be on the 5th of March. And it's conjunct to Lilith. But we've got some things leading up to that that I want to talk about before I move into this full moon. And that's that we're just coming off this Sun-Neptune thing. Sun-Neptune has dissolved our boundaries a bit, made things maybe a low vibration, can make things a little bit confusing, make things a little bit diffused. The Sun likes to really shine and be definite and be clear. The Sun brings clarity. Think when something's sunlit, that's when you can see it the best. It's the most clear. Neptune's all about diffusing boundaries and making things unclear, dissolving the ego, whereas the Sun is the ego. It is the conscious self. It is the individual self. Neptune's all about dissolving that. So some of us have maybe been feeling that can create some anxiety because the ego doesn't like to be dissolved, so it may feel like it needs to defend itself. So we maybe have been feeling that way over the last couple of days, a little defeated perhaps at a low vibration. At a higher vibration, if we've allowed that energy to, if we've gone with it, gone with the current, gone into the water, let ourselves be submerged and come up and not resisted the flow of the universe with outside of us and also within us, perhaps there was a more positive experience of feeling oneness and feeling, you know, perhaps, you know, we can make some art like that or, most of us have a mixed vibrational experience with these kinds of things because Neptune can be so overwhelming. It's like getting tossed into the sea and, you know, that kind of an experience, maybe feeling a little bit lost, a little bit, adrift. I would say adrift. So that's passing, but we're just sort of coming off of that. I sort of think of this like we're all sort of on this wave being sort of washed up on the shore now, and that Neptune Sun thing may have made us feel like, you know, like just putting our heads right up our asses and not really dealing with things because it's like you know, but there are some energies now coming into play. We've got an eclipse this month. We're moving into eclipse season. We've got two eclipses coming up, one this month and one next month, but the full moon is coming. We've got this Venus this week is going to be making these squares with Uranus and Pluto. We're going to get into detail with that in just a moment. Mars is following not far behind, doing the exact same thing. Venus and Mars are all about relationships. Venus being the divine feminine, Mars being the divine masculine, the lovers. So while the Sun is the great father and the Moon is the great mother, Venus is the lover, the anima, and Mars is the animus. And so, and all those archetypes all overlap as well, but they are Shiva and Shakti. And And so, Venus, Shakti, the power. The erotic. Eros meaning life force. Her son in the mythology was Cupid, Eros, Aphrodite, Venus's son. She produces that which is erotic. The ability to really live is the ability to engage in that flow of Eros. If you're not in that, it's really hard to feel alive. Truly alive. I think all creativity comes from Eros in some way. Even when we're not feeling Eros, it comes from that, because that's even an experience to have. The being in flow with that, and then the contrasting experience of not. So it's all an experience. So part of our task is just the awareness of its presence in the lower chakras here, and how that connects to these upper chakras, which is part of the task right now with this this moon coming up. Again, it's going to be conjunct Lilith. So Venus will be making a conjunction with Uranus, right, in Aries, and making a square with Pluto. So she's still in Aries. She's in this fiery sign, making conjunction with Uranus. Uranus is conjunct the South Node right now, which is the dragon's tail. The dragon's tail being where we've already been, Uranus being the awakener, Aries being about the self, right? Pow! Let's wake up, you know? With Venus going over this point, this is going to be like, you know, awakening to our own value, perhaps. You know, Venus is about self-value. Venus is about self-love. Venus is about complete self-acceptance. Venus in the mythology is always nude, and there's a reason for this. It's because she is beauty. She is beauty without shame. She is beauty. There's nothing to hide for her because she is love itself. There's nothing to hide. She is completely open. She comes out of the ocean, completely open. Now, with this transit, with her making a square to these two planets, Uranus, as I said, is the awakener. He's conjunct the South Node. She's going to be meeting him there. This is like I said, awakening. This is a big awakener as far as relationships are concerned. Our patterns, our old patterns, it's the South Node in relationship. Getting conscious about that. Getting conscious about how our old patterns in relationship relate to any feelings of non-acceptance, any feelings of shame, any feelings of low self-worth. Venus is about value. She's all about value. So awakening to our value or lack of experiencing value. Sometimes we think of self-love as somehow narcissistic. We equate those two things, and this is not true. Narcissism actually comes from, whether it's actually the personality disorder, if it's gone that far, or just behavior patterns that are narcissistic, selfishness, self-centeredness, comes from lack. It comes from not having enough self-love, true self-love. Self-love doesn't come from what we have, it doesn't come from what we do, it doesn't come from who thinks we're cool, it doesn't come from who loves us, actually. It comes out of ourselves and our own ability to look within, look at ourselves, and say, I accept you, everything. I accept all the way that I feel, I accept that I think this way, I accept that I am who I am, I accept that I look this way, etc. That's where self-love comes from. It doesn't come from accomplishment, it doesn't come from ownership. Ownership of your other people. It comes from ownership of yourself. Yes. So that's part of the lesson right now, is that awakening to how it is that we do and do not value ourselves, right? And here's the thing. We have a lot of cultural stuff around selfishness, around humility, around service, that it is better, it is more virtuous to be of service, to be humble, makes us more likable by others. And I don't think it's entirely wrong, but the degree to which we're actually able to do that without feeling like we're giving something that we can't afford to give comes, is in direct relation to the degree to which we hold ourselves with self-value and nurture ourselves and are able to meet our own needs in this way. So continuing to make choices moment to moment that foster that, that are in alignment with that, that follow our joy. Venus is about bliss. She's about pleasure. She's about what makes us feel good. So she's going to get a big challenge. The Venus within us, all of us, the attraction principle, is going to get a big challenge from these planets. And she's also, in turn, going to activate them. So we've had this Uranus-Pluto square going on for a number of years, activating, sort of coming out of activation, activating, sort of pulsing on and off. They're trying to liberate us. They are inviting us to really get down with what it is that matters. Matters of ultimate concern. I believe it was Matthew Fox that talks about that in one of his books. He's an author. Matters of ultimate concern. Like, what is gonna matter at the end? And this brings me to something that I wanted to mention, actually, today. Because just to get really authentic about where I am and what I'm bringing to this this report today and what I'm feeling is the loss of a very, very important and special community member, someone who was a member of many communities, many of which I am also participate in, a sister. And she passed away a couple nights ago. And so this has been on my mind a whole lot for the last, for the last couple days. And we were very lucky, first of all, to have her in the world. She's a poet. In fact, I posted one of her poems to April's Astrology at one point. It was a response to a posting about Pluto Persephone. It's a very beautiful poem. So we shared it. I shared it with everyone. And she's a wonderful poet. And we're very lucky, not only that she was here, but that she was willing to and open with her process, dealing with the illness that she had. And she and her partner were sharing that whole process, the ups and the downs, the healing and the sense of loss and the just the profound beauty of this happening and up until the very end. And this has been a great gift to all of us who have been able to witness it. And I was in conversation with another friend about this last night, that some of us are here to be that light and to, I think she's one of those people, to give us this gift. And we go through this collectively. We went through this with her, going through this now, bringing us to get better acquainted with our own matters of ultimate concern. The big picture. What is going to matter when it's our time to go? And when we're looking back at our own lives and the meaning of being here, what's going to matter and what's maybe not going to matter quite as much? We're reminded today. Yesterday, was this news was moving out into the community. And many people were reflecting on that and having their own responses to this. What is it that matters? And we're only here for a little while. Do we want to live? This person was a very free valued freedom and beauty and love? Do we want to live with that in mind, or do we want to constrict into petty things, identifying with things, identifying with control, with accomplishments? And I am not saying that we shouldn't exert control over our lives. I'm not saying that accomplishments don't matter, because they do. But what do we want to accomplish? What's the quality of it? What do we, again, coming back to Venus, what do we want to value? What do we value? What do we want to prioritize here? Are we spending our time on things that we don't really value? Or are we spending it on things that matter? And our navigational system for this is our feelings, how we feel. So if you're going through your day feeling badly, you're wasting your time. If you're going through your day ignoring how you feel, ignoring that navigational system, it's telling you to turn left, turn left, turn left, and you're going straight because you think you have to, you ought to, that's the only way because I'm obligated to, I'm afraid not to. I'm going to ask you, because this is on my mind a lot, I'm going to ask you to consider, moment to moment, making the choice based on ultimate concern. What's going to matter at the end? When I can't make this choice anymore, what would I be wishing that I had made? What choice will I be wishing I had made right in this moment? Not assuming I've got a million other times that I'm going to do this and today I'm going to go with fear. Or today I'm going to go with whatever. Feed whatever negative things going on. So I am going to ask you to try that out. Ask yourself, if I loved myself, what would I do in this moment? Even the small things. Because in matters of ultimate concern, the small things matter because that's what builds your life, are the small things, the small choices, the small gestures towards yourself and other people. Being kind to somebody else can be also kindness to yourself. Being kind to yourself and giving yourself enough so that you're not coming from a place of lack, you're not coming from a place of aversion, you're instead going toward a place of love, a place of inspiration. Right? That's what opens up our lives so that we can be in alignment with our bliss and in alignment with what we're here to actually do. It's finite, folks. It's finite. It's not going to be forever. Venus making a square with the god of the underworld. He's known as Hades, Lord Death. So he's a reminder of our mortality as well. He's also about power. He's about empowerment or the contrasting experience of not being empowered. That often brings us to, whoa, wait a minute, I don't feel empowered right now. What would make me feel empowered? So we have contrasting experiences when we're dealing with Pluto. Pluto's also about sexuality. Venus and Pluto are both about sexuality. So they're about, Pluto's about the dark, unconscious realms of sexuality. He's about the deep psyche and what it is that really turns us on from that deep unconscious place. Venus is also about sexuality. Her son Eros, Cupid, Aphrodite's son Cupid, Venus's son Eros, erotic, life force. She is the goddess. She is the Shakti. She is that energy. She is the power. She is that. She is the Kundalini force. And so Kundalini, this brings me to the full moon, conjunct black moon Lilith. So we've got Venus making this square with Uranus and Pluto. This is going to bring up a lot of stuff in relationships. Venus conjunct Uranus, the South Node. This is going to bring up our old relationship patterns, things that we're sort of still stuck in. I think of the Devil card in the tarot with the chains around the neck, sort of stuck to something. What is it that we're sort of stuck to? What are we bound to that isn't really serving us at this point? That maybe we need to honor. There may have been a good reason why we had this. Our psyches are infinitely brilliant. There's always a positive intention behind any negative behavior, but we've got to get to why it is the way that it is if we want to liberate ourselves from it. It has to be honored, has to be held the way that we would hold a child who is, it's our own inner child that's probably holding us in these places because there's a piece of our soul is stuck where we're traumatized, and everybody's been traumatized. There's nobody who hasn't been traumatized. This life is traumatizing. So we all have pieces of soul that are stuck somewhere. Lilith was called by Jung, Carl Jung, the psychologist, the shamanistic anima. So she's the medicine. And yet our culture rejects her as being dangerous because she brings in this wild, untamed wilderness energy into any situation. She says, I am the soul of every living creature that creepeth. In other words, she is the instinctual self. She is the lower chakras. She's the kundalini force. But it's the kundalini force. We're talking about Uranus on the south node with Venus. Square Pluto. God of the underworld. Lower chakras. Uranus. Higher chakras. We're talking about kundalini is what awakens us and opens that third eye. That's what makes us evolve. So you can't suppress the lower chakras. You can't suppress the lower nature, the animal nature, the shamanistic anima, the soul inside of us, of every living creature that creepeth. The wilderness within ourselves. We can't suppress that and expect to be able to become spiritually evolved in the higher chakras. That's spiritual shortcutting. It doesn't work. We got to be in connection to the divine feminine, to the dark feminine. This is a Virgo full moon. Virgo means virgin. It means whole unto oneself. So we get back around to what I was originally talking about, self-love, self-value, being able to be a self-contained unit that also relates to other people, because we're not supposed to be independent. We're primates, we're mammals, we're supposed to be connecting to each other. We need relationships. We can't just, there's no such thing as a, you know, we're not intended to be lone wolves. Even that idea, the lone wolf. Wolves don't do well alone. That's just somebody's fantasy. Wolves actually are in packs. They are very interdependent. So we're striving towards interdependency. Striving away, hopefully, from codependency. From the codependency is mutual psychic vampirism. It's you fill my cup, I'll fill your cup. You fill my cup, I'll fill your cup. But nobody can fill their own cup, right? The cup, the grail, the heart. The heart being the connector between the lower chakras and the upper chakras. Right here. Navigational system number one. Full moon is the opposition of the sun and the moon. This is the full moon is when the masculine and the feminine, the Shakti and the Shiva, look at each other, behold one another. In Virgo, we're looking at, I think of the union. Virgo means to integrate. So we're looking at the union, the integration of energies. Virgo is also about health, diet, and the combination and the integration of sexuality and spirituality. So you see where picture is forming here. We've got Lilith, the one's true nature, aside from culture, aside from socialization. She's just that raw nature that's within all of us. Kundalini energy. We've got the awakening of Uranus, Venus on the south node. We've got the Uranus-Pluto square, liberation, wake up, connect it. We've got Venus-Pluto, get acquainted with your unconscious mind. Honor the dark, honor the shadows, honor the shades. That's what Persephone had to do, that's how she became queen. She went down into the underworld and said, all right, you know, eventually. You know, there may be that experience that we have with these energetics that are going on that may feel like a violation because we feel like life is somehow forcing us to change and we don't really want to. We want things to stay the same. We want things to stay safe. We want things to stay easy. But they're not gonna under these circumstances. Go with it. Go with it. See if you can go with it. Notice your resistance in these moments. Honor the fact that that resistance is there. Don't get resistant to resistance. What you resist persists. Say, all right, I'm resistant to this. I don't want to do this. I have every right to feel that way. There's nothing that you feel that's wrong, ever. There's nothing wrong with you. There's nothing that you can possibly have a feeling about that's wrong. All feelings have a reason for being. They are trying to show us. They are messengers. They are energetics that are passing through us. We're more than our feelings. We're more than our thoughts. Virgo has to do also with mastery, with work, with efficiency, with, again, integration. Integrity and integration are the same root word. How to be in integrity. Integrity means to have all parts of ourselves present. Virgo's about wholeness, whole unto oneself, to be virgin. To be virgin also is to experience the world anew, moment to moment, and not get stuck in what you already think you know about it, how everything is and how you are. But approaching the world with newness again and again and again. That's also the principle of the sign of Aries, which Mars and Venus are in right now. Shiva and Shakti are in Aries, the first sign of the zodiac, the new bloom, the rebirth. So, there's a lot going on here. It's a big week. Again, just to sort of sum it up, matters of ultimate concern. What does that mean to you when you think of matters of ultimate concern? What does that mean to you? And how might you, moment to moment, honor the value of what that means to you and what you value? And with that, this report is complete. Again, check out the astrology, the intermediate astrology class, Astrology 2, and the link is down below. And I'd love to hear what you have to say. Please always feel free to leave your comments on the videos, on my Facebook page. Send me a message. I love to talk with you and hear your thoughts. Have a wonderful week. Take care.